Hi everyone, welcome to our fourth lecture this semester. Today we'll talk about sets and maps in the Java Collections framework. We'll have a quiz for the day on basically using sets. You can also use maps in this case for counting consonants and vowels in a text that is read from a file, and we are going to use a set to store the letters. Also, we can actually use a map to store the counts. And I have a solution that I want to show you. It's also posted on Piazza, and we'll go over it at the end of the class today. So today's lecture will be on sets and maps, how to use them from the Java Collections framework. Later this semester, we'll actually learn how to implement them in a similar way. So the objectives for today's lecture are to store unordered, non-duplicate elements using sets, to explore how and when to use the different kinds of sets in Java Collections framework: hash set, linked hash set, or tree set, which is a sorted set to store elements, to compare the performance of sets versus lists, to use sets to develop a program that counts the distinct keywords in a Java source file. It's kind of similar to the one that we do for the quiz today, but in this case, we are basically using it to map all of the keywords in a Java source code, to tell the difference between collection and map, and describe when and how to use hash map, linked hash maps, and tree maps to store values associated with keys. So basically, there are two different hierarchies. One is the collections hierarchy, and one is the map hierarchy. And we'll see the difference between the two. And basically, map is used for the different kinds of dictionaries that are in Java. Then we'll have an example on how to use maps to develop a program that counts the occurrences of words in a text. So basically, not only to keep the different keywords, but also to count the number of times that each keyword appear in the text. Then we will learn how to obtain singleton sets, lists, and maps, and unmodifiable sets, lists, and maps using the static methods in collections class. So if you have any questions during the class, again, there are two different ways. You can unmute yourself, and I basically will see your question in the chat for the class. And the second way is to, I will hear your question if you unmute yourself. The second way is to put it in the chat. And from time to time, I will just take a break and see the questions in the chat. So the motivation problem for today is really basically sets versus maps and in problems. So suppose that you need to write a program that checks whether a student is in a class. So you can store the names of students in the class in a list. And in either way that you store them, in unordered way or with ordered way, you pay a price to find the student. So in the case that the students are unsorted, you will search the student with a linear search. And the time complexity for that is O(n). Basically, it's in the worst case, you need to iterate over all the students to find that student that you're looking for. A more efficient way would be to have a sorted list of all the students in the class, in which case you will pay a price of log n. Basically, you will use binary search to look at the student in the middle, discard half of the students with name less than or greater than the student that you were looking for, and then look in the middle of the remaining list, and so on. However, a more efficient way for this application is a set. And in general, without collisions, you would basically get a constant time of one to find the student in the set. Suppose now that your program also needs to store detailed information about the student in the class. So you can't just use a set of strings with the name of the student. Now, for that, you would basically need a map. So once you find the key, the student with that name, then you can get the information, the value of corresponding to that key. So you can get in detailed information like the grades of the labs, the homework submissions, the submission times, the GPA, and so on. So in this case, the name of the student will be the key in that map or dictionary, and the value would be that detailed information. Basically, it could be an object that contains more information about the student. And for that, you need a map, basically to map keys to value pairs. So really, most applications that you will write will use maps or sets in order to have an efficient implementation. Now, to review the collection framework, the Java collection framework hierarchy from last time, we basically did lists and queues, but one of the interfaces that extended the collection interface was set interface. And we can actually see that there are multiple concrete classes that can be used to store sets in Java, and those are hash set, linked hash set, and tree set. And today we'll talk about this part of the hierarchy, and we'll see that there is a separate hierarchy for maps in Java collection framework. So just to refresh what we were basically talking about last time as a reminder, basically we have the collection interface that has all of the common methods available for any collection in Java, add to add elements in the collection, clear to clear the collection, contains to check if an element is in the collection. Now we can see that this is actually an abstract method because it's implemented in different ways in the different type of collections. In lists, you would have to iterate with linear search, as opposed in sets, you would basically use hashing to find the element in a constant time. Then there are other methods like isEmpty, remove to remove elements, remove all, retain all, size, and toArray. Now, the collection interface implements the iterator interface, which basically has one abstract method, iterator, that returns an iterator for the collection. And from last time, we remember that an iterator pattern has basically a method to check for the next element, which returns a Boolean, returns the basically if there is a next element after the current position of the cursor in a data structure, in a sequence in this case. Then there is a next method to actually return the next element and move the iterator to the next element and remove the current element that is pointed by basically the next method. So this collection interface is the root interface for all of the collections in Java. And in particular, it's implemented by the set interface. The set interface extends the collection interface, and it introduces new methods for sets and stipulates that the set has no duplicate elements. So basically, in a set, you cannot store duplicate elements. A duplicate element, if you try to add it, it will not be added because it's already there. And duplicate means equals. So as long as the equals method returns true between one of the elements in the set and the element that we want to add, it will not be added to the current set. So equals is the definition of duplicate element. So as long as two elements, E1 and E2, are equal, with E1 equals E2 returns true, no, the second element will not be added to the set. That's the definition of duplicate in Java. So now any concrete subclass that implements the set interface must ensure this condition that no duplicate elements will be added to the set. And really the requirement is because the internal implementation of set is with HashMap, which will detect this case that there are duplicates elements if there are such duplicates. So now the first implementation that we care about is abstract set. The abstract set partially implements the set interface. So it's an abstract class It contains implementation of most of the methods in set, which are inherited from collection, like add, remove, and so on. But it's still an abstract class. It basically is, you can't create a new object instance of an abstract set. So this abstract set class provides all the concrete implementation for equals method, for the hashCode method. The hashCode of a set is the sum of the hashCodes of the all the elements in the set. So a hashCode can be equal between two sets, but it may be because there are basically two sums that are equal, not because the two hash sets contain the same elements. Since the size method and the iterator method are not implemented in the abstract set class, this abstract set is an abstract class. It will basically be implemented by the subclasses, these three concrete subclasses of sets. So the set interface hierarchy is that the set interface implements the collection, extends the collection interface. Then it basically has an implementation for abstract set, but then there are basically three subclasses, concrete subclasses of abstract set. Hash set, which is the most used class. Linked hash set, which is implemented with a linked list. So basically the difference between the two is that one is implemented with an array list internally, of course with hashing on top of it, and the other one is with a linked list internally. So they have differences in efficiency between different tasks. So adding within a collection will be done faster for linked hash sets, as opposed to adding at the end, and just retrieval is done faster by a standard hash set. Now, if we also want the sorting of the elements in the hash set, that is done through the tree set concrete class, which implements not only the set interface, but also the sorted set interface. So basically, we can specify either by comparable or comparator a sorting order when we create a tree set. And then we can get a set of non-duplicated elements, but we can also get ordered in efficient manner of the elements. So as opposed to hash set, which basically implements the fact that there are no duplicates by using hashing, tree set will implement it with a sorted list. So the hash set class is the most used concrete class that implements a set. You can basically create an empty hash set using the no argument constructor, or you can create a hash set from an existing collection. And it's really basically a hash set that creates first an empty hash set, and then it adds all of the elements from the existing collection one by one to this new hash set. Strings are not sorted in the stored in the order in which they are inserted in the set. They're in any set, in any hash set, there is no particular order for the elements in the hash set. And that the reason why is that actually for strings and for other elements, a hash value is computed. And we'll talk a little bit more about how that hash value is computed for strings, for integers, for hash sets, in fact. If you want to sort an order of the elements that will be basically inserted, you can sort them either by the order in which they were inserted, and in that case, you would use a linked hash set. Or if you want a sort based on the comparable interface, you would use a tree set, which we'll see next. So by default, the initial capacity of a hash set is 16 elements, and the load factor is 0.75. Load factor is a number, a double between 0.0 and 1.0. And what exactly it means is how full is the set versus the capacity of the set. So 0.75 means 75% occupancy of the capacity. So if you have 10 the capacity, 0.75 would mean seven elements, or 0.7 would mean seven elements in that hash set. So what load factor means is what is the value at which the set can be basically before its capacity is increased. So if the load capacity is 0.75 and we have an initial capacity of 10 elements, let's say 10 elements, and we have seven elements already, the moment that we want to insert the eighth element in the hash set, basically we have to increase the capacity. So it will not add the eighth element before it doubles the capacity of the hash set. And then it can add the next element, because at that moment the load factor is basically only 0.35, because now we have 20 elements capacity and we still have the seven elements that we had before. So when the number of elements exceeds the product of the capacity with the load factor, the capacity is automatically doubled. So for instance, and here is an example, if the capacity is 16, the load factor is 0.75. The moment that the size reaches 12 is basically 16 multiplied with 0.5, the capacity with the load factor, the capacity will be doubled to 32 elements, double the 16 that we had before. A higher load factor decreases the space, but it increases the search time. So for instance, if we have a load factor of 0.9, then actually what happens with hashing is that it actually, we pay a higher price for search, because of collisions, many elements can actually get the same hash value. And therefore they are actually stored in memory in some collision avoidance scheme, which could be a linear collision avoidance. So we have to skip the next nine elements before we can get into a space that we can store the current element. So 0.75 is a good trade-off between how much space you want to have unallocated. Basically, you want to increase the space of the data structure, versus how much time you pay for searching an element. And we'll basically implement it ourselves next in a couple of lectures. Before, actually, let me talk about hash codes, and then if you have any question about the load factor and capacity, we can return to them next. And really what hash code is a value that is computed for any object that gives you in an array that may store the elements of that hash set, the location where you can put that element in the hash set. So this hash code is basically defined, is a method defined in the object class. Every single object in Java has a hash code. And the hash codes of two objects must be the same if the two objects are equal based on the equals method, but not vice versa. If two objects are not equal, they may still have the same hash code, and that's a hash code collision. Basically, you get two objects that have the same hash code, but they are not equal. They have some different value. They are not equal with the equals method in Java. So two unequal objects may have the same hash code, but you still implement the method has hash code to avoid as many such cases as you can. So you have to avoid such cases that you have two unequal objects with the same hash code. Now, Java implements hash code for many different objects, all of the API objects. For instance, the wrapper type integer hash code is just the int value of that integer. For character is the Unicode code for that character. For string, we already have a method for hash code, which is the following. You take the characters of the string, like S0 is the character at index 0, multiplied with 31 to the power of the length of the string minus 1, plus the second character, the character at index 1, multiplied with 31 to the power n minus 2, where again n is the length of the string, and so on up to the last character s of n minus 1, multiply with 31 to the power 1, to the power 0. So basically you have multiplied with 1. So si is s dot character at index I, and so on. And 31 is has a property. It's an odd number. It's an odd prime number with the property that basically when you want to raise it to some power, you only have to do, and you have to multiply it with some number I, whatever I is, it basically it's a shift. So you shift I with 5 positions to the left and subtract I out of it. So it has this basically nice property that in fact you don't need to do these multiplications. You can basically just do this operation a number of times, n minus 1 times. And modern VMs actually do this extremely efficiently. It's a nice optimization. Okay. Now, before we continue with basically hash set and iterator, let's see if everybody understood all the problems that we had here. So basically we had hash code, which is a method defined for any object in Java. Then the value that is returned by this hash code is basically a position internal in the hash set class, which gives us a position in that array list that basically where the object is stored. Now, the problem is that you don't, the ideal case, you have a different hash code for every basically different string. So you can get in constant time where the object is located in the hash map, or you can actually store it in the hash map. However, you can't have perfect hashing. It's not always the case that you will get the same position, basically one position for one object. You basically will get two objects that are not equal at the same position. So in that case, there is a hash collision avoidance scheme, which could be a linear, or there are basically a few more efficient ways to actually find the next available position. You can actually use any kind of scheme to do that, finding the of the position. Instead of going to the next sequential element, you can skip in powers of two. So if the next position is not available, you will jump at the fourth position, then at the eighth position, then at the 16th position, and so on. And then basically you have a better avoidance mechanism for moving to find the position in the hash set. In addition to that, basically there is this idea of load factor that only 75% of your hash set is populated. So basically you will get lower probability that you are going to hit another element in the hash set. So the capacity and the load factor basically gives you a different position, and then you have to rehash basically the elements in the hash set because the hash value may not be the same given taking into consideration that you have a bigger capacity now. So let's see if there are any questions. We'll actually have an entire lecture later this semester on hashing and implementing hashing ourselves. But at this point, this is, I think, enough to actually understand how hash set works internally. So any questions? Now, you can already see that even this hash, computing a hash string, a hash code for a string is not enough. You can have collisions easily. But in the same time, you can't implement perfect hash code schemes. hash code computing. So for instance, there is Gödel numbering, which will give you for every string a different hash code. But Gödel numbering is implemented, if you read about it, as sequential prime numbers, so 3, 2, 3, 5, and so on. So instead of using the same value here, you are going to use a different prime number, and that you will basically will give you and basically it's a little bit different. So actually, let me just show you an idea. So let's say that you have a string, and the unicodes of that string are 1, 2, 3, and so on. It's not quite, basically, it's not true that one's unicode is 1, but it's fine enough. Gödel numbering basically says construct a product of sequential prime numbers, so 2 to the power 1 multiplied with the next prime number, 3 to the power 2 multiplied with 5 to the power 3, and so on. So basically, the idea is that you, for different strings, so even for a different string, now you have 2, 1, 3, and then your prime number, your Gödel numbering is going to be 2 to the power 2 multiplied with 3 to the power 1 multiplied with 5 to the power 3. But unique factorization theorem says basically that all of this will be different. So basically, for no matter what string you will have, you will get a unique hash code for it. However, you can already see that if you have a string of 100 characters, you have a product of 100 prime numbers with huge powers. So you can store this in memory. So it's a perfect hash scheme that guarantees that you are getting a different number for every input string, but you can't store it. So basically, you have to have a compromise of what is a good hashing function. So that's all I want to say about hashing, if there are questions.
Professor?
Yeah, go ahead.
So some people in the chat were mentioning that, like, when you check to see, when you want to add something to a set and you check to see, like, if it's a duplicate or not, you can do that in constant time because of a hash code. Could you explain again, like, how that works?
Excellent question. So basically, first you compute a hash code. Now, you have to, so the way that basically hashing works is that internally there is some kind of an array. So let's actually use paint. Okay. So the input, let's say, are two strings, and somehow these strings have the same hash code, let's say. They don't, but let's say that they do have the same hash code. So they are mapped to the same hash code. So some function that has a collision, that it gives me a code. And this will be used as an index in an array list, or in an array, basically, that stores the elements in the hash table. So somewhere this code corresponds to the index of this element here. And this will basically be the reference to that string that will be stored in memory. So if hi was the first one introduced, this is a reference to the string that contains hi. Now, the next string, hello, will be, we want to add it to the hash map. So we compute the hash code, the code is already taken. So if the code is already taken, it basically looks now for the next position. If basically this implements linear collision avoidance, the next position in the array list, and if that is available, it will basically put that string there. So if you are looking again for the string hello, it will basically look at this code, it sees hi, but it cannot stop. It basically says, me, it's one of the next elements in the hash map, in the hash set. So it looks at the next element and it says hello, and it says, yes, it's in the hash set. If 75% of these elements are basically occupied, in the worst case, and they are sequential, and all of them basically have some link to a string, it doesn't have to be something that maps the same code. It still has to iterate over all of them until it finds an empty position, and then it can say, hello is definitely not here. So that's why if this number is basically larger, you pay a larger price to search if the element is in the hash map. Okay? So hashing doesn't give you a perfect complexity of constant complexity to find an element. It basically only gives you a perfect case that element is not there, or if it's there, if it's followed in that array that contains the elements by an empty position. So if the code would have been the code of this element prior to the empty slot, then I can say, and this element was either that string, or if it was not, I can say, oh yes, I know the answer because the next position is not empty. And this is because in this collision avoidance scheme, it tells me that it's linear, that I didn't find it up to the next element that is empty. Now there is an other collision avoidance schemes in which you basically will skip, instead of going to the next element and going sequentially, it skips in powers of 2. So if it's not the next element at index 2, it jumps to 4. And since that is empty, I can directly say immediately that hello is not there, or if it's there, it's there. So let's go over the questions. There were plenty of questions. So every time you want to add something to the set, you have to check all elements to see if it's not a duplicate. No. So the answer to that is that you start from the one that has the position that has the code that you basically computed as the hash code for that element. And then based on the collision avoidance scheme, you may have to continue. Or the moment that you get an empty position, you can say, this element is not there, and that's it. So the answer to your first question basically is, do we have to check all the elements to see if it's not a duplicate? Is no, we don't have to check all the elements. We have to check the elements with starting with the same hash code. If it's there, if there is a position occupied, if it's not occupied, we can immediately say it's not there. And then depending on the hash, the collision avoidance scheme, we can basically iterate over the elements that are in that sequence. And in the moment that we reach an empty position, we can say is not there. So not really, because it runs in constant time. It's not quite constant time. I mean, a perfect hash code will give you constant time, but no hash codes are perfect. Basically, there you have to avoid them using the collision avoidance scheme. In theory, that is done in linear search time. Yes, that's true. And again, we are returning back to the load factor, because if the load factor is a small number, so only like say 10% of the hash set is occupied, then it's higher probability that you basically will give a constant time, a lower time to tell the user that it's not there in one second or in one step. Okay, TO is responding. I believe in this slide will make more sense. Yeah, I think I covered basically what a hash set does internally. It computes the hash code. It will tell you the position. For duplicates, it has to avoid the collision. So it basically will you pay a hard higher time than just constant time, usually linear. But that's when you have a hash lookup. That's true. There were more questions. Let's continue. So you have to run a hash code generation process for the element. That's the hash code computation, and see if the hash code is present in the hash map, and also continue over the elements that you basically, if it's already taken that position by an element that is not equal with the element that we are looking for, you have to continue with the hash code collision scheme to actually find if the element is there. So in most, in theory is constant, but in practice is a little bit more than constant. What's the difference between using a set and an array list? For an array list, to find an element, you pay linear time, so O of n, if they are not sorted. And for sets, you are basically paying constant time or worse. So it's basically, in most cases, based on the load factor. For a load factor of 0.5, you will basically have a probability of 25% that you will get a constant time. So, and the other difference, as ChainChain notices, is that lists, array lists allow duplicates, sets don't. A set doesn't have duplicates, so all elements are unique, but some sets are implemented using array lists internally and is done, as I basically mentioned, with that figure. The order, sets can have order, and basically we'll talk about that. You can have a tree set or even a linked set. A linked set contain the order that the elements will be also stored in the linked set is basically the way that the order that they were added to the linked set. So on top of the hash set, there is also a linked list that actually contains the order of the elements that they were added. So there are, it's a linked list with references to the elements in the hash set. And when you iterate with an iterator, you will get the elements in the order in which they were added to the hash set. So order is basically a complementary issue to the fact that this is a set or an array. What problem does it solve by not having duplicates? The fact that you want to store individual unique objects, like unique students or unique keywords. So that's a good purpose for using a set instead of an array list. Also, the other issue is efficiency. For a set, you get a better comparison time, so you can get, in the best case, a constant time to access an element if you don't know the index of that element, as opposed to an array or an array list. So it's more efficient lookup time for sets than arrays. And Quinton mentions that in the collision avoidance scheme, if all the elements are basically in following spots, then you basically are full, then does it double the size of the set? If the number of elements is greater than the load factor, then it doubles the size of the capacity of the hash set. So just the fact that they are consecutive elements stored doesn't really actually double the size. So it could be the fact that we have, let's say, a big array list and all of these elements are available. I'm not drawing straight lines, but these are all available, and it's the case that we have all of the elements clumped together somewhere, and we are using a linear avoidance scheme. It doesn't double the number, the capacity, if the load factor is not great, if the load factor is still basically less than that, how full is the array? So it's still greater than how full is that array list. So basically, it doesn't matter if elements are clubbed together. Still, basically, the load factor tells us when do we double the capacity. Yeah, go ahead.
So in terms of the load factor, what would the advantage of having 0.75 be as opposed to like just a high, like just having it by default be one? Would it be like the amount of memory that you take up with that hash set, or?
Yes.
Okay.
And the other thing is that really there are, I mean, it's very unfortunate to have this clumped together. So 0.75 really means that in a hash set, let me actually use a rectangle, that it's very high probability that in your hash set, for every four elements, basically that are linked, you have a probability that the next element is available. So it's usually the case that in three elements, you will find one that is available. So you basically will still get close to constant factor because three is a constant. So 75 is actually pretty good. It will tell you that there is a high probability that you will get a constant factor. It's very seldom that you have clumps in your hash set. Even
in, with the disadvantage of clumping in the case of a hash set?
Again?
What would the disadvantage of a clump be in terms
of a what? Sorry.
Clump.
Of one. One means that your entire hash set is full. So basically, let's say that only one position is empty at the end, and we are getting the code of the input object being the first element. And now, in order to find if that element is in the hash set, in the worst case, you will pay the price of the entire size of the hash set, because you have to iterate over all of these elements to find if that element. So the element that we are looking for is different than the element that we have here. Then you still have to iterate over all of the rest of the elements to find if that element was not somewhere here, because basically we had to avoid the same code and we skipped all of these elements.
Okay, so it's looking at the optimized trade-off between
exactly
for searching along with the amount of times you have to add it,
the size that you need for the hash set. So a smaller number for the load factor will tell you that basically there is a lot of space that is unused in your hash set. So 0.3 means that 70% of your memory is actually unused. 1.0 means that there is nothing unused, but in order to find an element, you will have to pay the price in the size of the hash set. So if your hash set contains, let's say, a dictionary of 100,000 words, searching a word will actually, you pay the price of iterating over all the words in the dictionary. So that's why, so let me actually write it down because I think this is quite important. Let's create a duplicate slide and just say low load factor, like for instance 0.3 means that 70% of your memory is unused, and the high load factor like for instance 1.0 means that the search time for one element would be the size of your entire memory hash. So in the case of 0.5 is a compromise. It basically says that the search time is most likely linear, constant, and the memory is at most 25% unused. So this is really what this whole thing means. So it's better to have basically 75% load factor. It's neither that you are losing too much memory or that you are paying a high price for searching.
Okay, that makes more sense. Thank you.
And really, I think the basically what exactly is the load factor is the number of elements that you have that you put in the hash set versus the capacity of the hash set. So, but this is that limit, like what is the maximum load factor that you can have. So up to when you get to 75%, you could have any number below that, like maybe 30% is occupancy or 20% or 50%. When you get to 75%, then you basically have to double for this load factor of 0.75. Okay. Other questions? Yep, that's exactly what Thomas says. That higher load factor means more positions to look when looking for an item in the hash that already was filled with something else, which makes searching slower because you will have to iterate through the next elements to actually find that one element that you're looking for. And as I said, there are many different avoidance schemes, and we will talk about them later. So linear, quadratic, double hashing, and so on. So linear really means, as you can see here, and we'll go over this later this semester, is that if, so 26 was the element that we want to put, and a simple basically hash code is that you do modulo the number of positions that you have in the hash set. So for this number, for 11 positions, 26 and 4 will get the same remainder after division with 11, which is 4. So basically, if that position is taken, you have to look at the next element, the next element, the next element with linear probing. And there is quadratic probing. So if the next element is basically not available, then you will jump a power of 2. So basically you jump 4 elements next, and then you jump 8 elements, and basically you do that. And that basically avoids the case that you the next element it has not the same hash value with 4, but it's basically it could be 5. But if that is occupied, then an element that would be mapped to 5 will jump instead of to 8, will jump to 9. So you are avoiding some of those duplicates that you will basically get with linear probing. And that's what quadratic probing does. And then there is double hashing. So your first hash function will give you a value, and then you apply a second hash function will give you another index. And then you have, again, lower probability that you will meet, you will have a collision. So basically, there are many different ways to do this hashing to avoid collisions. And we'll cover them, as I basically said. And there are also separate chains. So instead of actually going to the next element, you keep a linked list of the elements that you want to store. So elements that basically have the same hash value will be at the same hash code, but you will pay the price of how many elements are basically in that linked list that are elements with the same hash code, basically. So there are different ways to avoid collisions, and we'll discuss them later this semester. The way that is implemented in hash set, I'm not exactly sure. So I will have to look for that if you have that question. How is hash set implemented in Java collection framework? I'm sure that is not linear probing, but it has to be some way to avoid collisions. I will look for that for next class. Okay. Let's see if there are any other questions. Okay, good. So let's see an example. So we want to use a hash set to fill it with strings and then an iterator to traverse the elements in a list. So here we create a hash set. We add multiple strings to that hash set: London, Paris, New York, San Francisco, Beijing, New York again. And because it's a hash set, it basically only has only one New York in it. So when we display the elements in the hash set, we'll basically get London, Paris, New York, San Francisco, Beijing in some order. It's a set. So basically it creates hashes for every one of those strings. Now, how do we print them? We can actually print them in multiple ways, but the way that I will actually learn, teach you how to do it with aggregates and streams in Java is the following. Basically, a stream is like a for each loop, but it's basically it's a special method in Java called for each that iterates over the elements in the stream and binds a variable e or any other variable to that stream. Is like a lambda function, and then for that element it invokes the system.out.print method. Next class will go over this type of aggregates over collections methods, and there are many different aggregates. There are aggregates to actually iterate over collections like this one. There are aggregates to create an aggregate to actually compute an aggregate function like sum, count, or any kind of other aggregate that you want to define yourself. And we'll do this. This was added in Java 8, I believe. And this is basically the preferred way to iterate over collections these days. So the hash set class, since a set is a collection, all the methods in collections are basically available for sets. We can write for each loops, which are using iterable interface to traverse the elements in the collection. And basically all the elements in all the sets are iterable because basically they are implemented by extending the collection interface. So here is an example of collection methods for sets. So the same set that we had before with those cities, we can get the size of the set that was one of the methods in collections. We can remove elements, we can add elements. We can create another hash set, and then we can actually check if an element Taipei is in the second hash set. We can add all the elements from set 2 to set 1. We can remove all the elements in set 2 from set 1. We can retain all of the elements in set 1, which have a value in the set 2 set. And that's basically it. And these are the outputs. So the first set has 5 elements. So New York only appeared once. Then after removing London, it basically contains 4 elements. The second set is Shanghai, Paris, and London. Taipei is not in that set. And basically this is returned in constant time. After adding set 2 to set 1, set 1 becomes San Francisco, New York, Shanghai, Paris, Beijing, and London. After removing set 2 from set 1, set 1 is San Francisco, New York, and Beijing. And after removing the common elements in set 2 from the current set 1, set 1 is empty. Linked hash set. So linked hash set is also a concrete hash set in Java, but it's internally implemented with a linked list over the hash set. And when you want to iterate over the elements of the hash of the linked hash set, you basically get an ordering of the elements in the set. And that default ordering, the default ordering is the order in which they were inserted in the set. So in the previous example, we saw that we inserted the elements in some order, London first, Paris second, and so on. But when we actually printed them, we saw that they are San Francisco, New York. So London is not first. In fact, London is the last one here. And that's because hashing will basically put it somewhere in the hash set based on the hash code, not based on the ordering in which they were inserted or on the ordering of the strings. So linked hash set basically retains that order. It's a hash set with a linked list on top of it, which basically keeps the order in which the elements were inserted. If you want a different order, basically the string order, lexicographical order, then you can use a tree set. So a tree set is basically an order that basically is a link order, but it's sorted. So basically you will insert the elements when you insert them in sorted order, kind of like with binary search. So first, let's see an example of a linked hash set. So I basically created another set that I added the same elements, London, Paris, New York, San Francisco, Beijing, and New York again. And this is stored in a linked hash set. And when we print the elements from that linked hash set, it basically prints them in order, London, Paris, New York, San Francisco, and Beijing. And that's the advantage of linked hash sets. Tree set is a sorted set, and sorted set is an sub-interface of set, which guarantees that the elements are sorted based on some comparable interface. Navigable set extends a sorted set with additional methods. You can get the lower of one element, is kind of like what you have for floor and ceiling of a real number. Basically, you get the element or the element less than the current element. So that's basically you're giving an element which may not be in the set. And then lower of E returns the element less than the element that you passed as a parameter. So let's say that you have A, C, and E in the set. And if I want the lower of B, it will give me A, because less than that element that I pass as the argument. The floor of, let's say, C is C, because it's less than or equal. The ceiling of C is C2, E, because it's greater, no, its ceiling is C, because it will be greater than or equal with the element that I pass as a parameter, and higher will be the element greater than the one that I passed as a parameter. So for a set that contains A, C, and E, higher than C will return basically E. Or it returns null if no such element exists. So for instance, for lower, if you pass an element that is lower than the lowest element in the tree set, then it will give me null, because there is no lower element than that limit. Poll first is basically kind of like a queue. It removes and returns the first element, and poll last in that tree set, it will basically remove and return the last element in the tree set. Head set, given an element, will return a portion of the elements whose elements are less than the two element. So basically all the elements less than will be now grouped together into a set, and returned back as the result of head set. Similar for tail set, it will return all the elements greater than or equal with the from element. So it's really if you want all the elements less than some value or all the elements greater than some value. You can use an iterator, and by default, you get the order of the elements. So one way is to basically use the comparable interface, and that will give you the lexicographical order for strings or whatever order you define for that object for comparable interface. And the other way is actually you create a tree set for a comparator object. So instead of using the comparable interface to compare the objects to sort them, it will use the object that you are implementing in comparator. So for comparable, it will use the compare to method, and for comparator, it will use the compare method. So tree set is the concrete implementation. It basically is you create a tree set, it implements all of the interfaces above it. It provides also two additional methods, first and last. First, it will return the smallest element in the sorted set, and last, it will return the last element in the sorted set. And you can add the elements in the tree set with the add method, and all of them must be comparable with each other with this compare method, compare or compare to, depending when you created the tree set, if you can create it without a comparator or with a comparator. So now I have an example using tree set. Basically, I have a set filled with strings, and then I create a tree set for the same strings, and they will be sorted in lexicographical order. So here is a set that basically is created for a hash set, and it will give me a order, but not the one that I'm expecting for sorted strings. And if I create a tree set for the same set, they will be ordered in lexicographical order. So the first one in this order, it will be Beijing because it starts with B. The last one, it will be San Francisco because it starts with S, the greatest letter as the first letters. The tree set up to New York will give me all the cities before New York, including New York, and the tail set after New York in lexicographical order. So here are the examples. So the sorted tree set is Beijing, London, New York, Paris, and San Francisco. First we return Beijing, last we return San Francisco. The head set before New York is Beijing and London. The tail set after New York is New York, Paris, and San Francisco. The sorted tree set is basically the same string as we saw before. Lower than P is New York. Higher than P is Paris. Floor of P is New York because P is not in the set. Ceiling of P is Paris, again, because P is not in the set. Pole first will remove and return Beijing. Pole last will return San Francisco. And the tree set after removing Beijing and San Francisco are London, New York, and Paris. And that's basically the methods one by one that were in the original program for that reset. Any questions about this example? No. Okay, good. Now you can also use a comparator to create a reset. So basically, when you create a tree set, you create it with a comparator. So let's assume that we have a geometric object comparator that compares two objects based on their area. And now, as I insert the elements, they will be sorted based on this method. So basically, the smallest object, which I believe is rectangle of 4, 1, will be added first. Then rectangle of 4, 4 will be the next one, and then it will have one circle of radius of 4. And that's basically the order that we are getting for the sorted list of geometric objects. And that's the output that you see on the bottom here. So this is an example of tree set, so which contains a set but also with an order on top of it. Of course, you will not get constant time to insert elements or to search for elements. Actually, searching, it will give you constant time because you are still using the hash value to search, because really you have a double data structure here. You have a hash set, which will give you relatively constant time, and you have a sorted a linked list, which basically gives you the sorted order. So for searching, you will basically use the hash code and you can get constant time for searching. For inserting, you have to insert in the hash map or hash set, but in addition to that, you have to actually insert it in the sorted linked list into the correct position, which is logarithmic time. So it's basically the worst of the two. To insert, it will take a logarithm in the size of the linked list. Any questions? One of the future lectures, we will actually talk about efficiency of algorithms. So again, later this semester, we will talk about developing efficient algorithms and the big O notation, the growth function. When you grow, let's say double the length, the size of the data structure, how much price you will pay for algorithms. A linear time will basically say that the growth rate is linear. If you double the size, you double the time. An exponential growth rate basically says that instead you have an exponential function. When you double the size, you actually have four times, or basically an exponential number of how many times you will extend the time. So it's four times. For a double the size, you will pay the four times the price to search. If you, let's say, quadruple the size, you will pay 16 times the search. And we'll start with sorting algorithms and other algorithms to see the complexity. Okay, good. So now, sets are more efficient than lists for storing non-duplicate elements. Lists are more efficient for accessing elements through the index because it guarantees constant time, as opposed to a set which doesn't guarantee constant time. Sets do not support indexing. Basically, you cannot access elements based on an index because the elements are unordered. And to traverse all the elements in a set, you will use a for each loop or one of those aggregates for collections that we will learn later. And here is an example. So actually, I took 50,000 elements, I inserted them into a linked list, into an array list, and then I shuffled the array list, and then I inserted all the same elements into a hash set. And for one element, I basically got the get the test, the time that basically for all elements, I basically got the time that it takes to access all the elements. And then I removed all the elements and I got the time. And then I created the second set for the same list of elements. And I got the time that was using a linked hash set. And I got the time to remove all of the elements. And these were the times. Basically, for membership test, it took 20 milliseconds in a hash set versus 27 milliseconds in a linked hash set. And there is a similar time for removing. So removing is about the same. Searching for linked hash sets is about 35% slower. So not that bad. Then I did the same test for a tree set, and then for an array list, and finally for a linked list. And I basically, the method for getting the time iterates over all of the elements from 0 to n. And it checks containment or it removes them. So what exactly were the times? For a hash set, we got 20 milliseconds. For linked hash set, we got 27. We already saw those. For a tree set, if you also contain keep the order in a separate data structure in the tree set, is double the time, so about 47 milliseconds, so almost double the time of a hash set of a linked hash set, and definitely double the time than the hash set. For an array list, because you have to iterate an element at a time, so let's say that I'm looking for 70,000 or 50,000, I have to go over all the elements linear search from the beginning to the end to find it. So it's basically three orders of magnitude slower, and removal is two orders of magnitude slower. Similar for linked lists. In fact, linked lists are worse than that, almost basically 50% higher than array lists, because you actually have to iterate not in an array, but you have to iterate in a linked data structure with elements linked one after another. And again, the removal time was faster, and this is really because removal in linked lists is faster. You don't need to shift elements. Any questions about times? Excuse me about that. Let me turn it off. Excuse me. Okay, so any questions? Okay, good. Let's see how we are doing with time. In theory, we should finish, but let's do maps. We take the time from the lab. Okay, so counting keywords is a simple application that uses sets. Basically, for each keyword that we find in a Java source file, we determine whether that word is a keyword and we put it in a set. And to handle that efficiently, we are using a hash set, and we use the contain method to check if that keyword was seen before. So here is the example. We basically ask the user to enter a Java source code, and then we read that name of the file. Then if that file exists, we call the function count keywords. I have an array that contains all of the keywords in Java from abstract to null. And then basically we have a set of all the keywords that were found in that set. Initially, basically we take the array that we have. Actually, this is the array of, this is the set of all of the keywords. So I transform that keywords into a set. Then for every next word that I read from the file, I basically split that word on any non-word character, and that will give me all of, for basically a line that I read, it will give me all of the words in individual words in that line. In fact, instead of next, I can use next line, and then instead of word, I can use line and split on any non-word character. And that's more understandable. Now we are getting an array of actual distinct words. And for every string in those, I check if it's a keyword. I check if in the keyword set, I have that word that I'm looking for. And then I'm incrementing the count if that is the case. So basically it counts the keywords that are in that file. So this is a simple example with using a set. A map interface. So a map is basically like a dictionary. You have a kind of like an index, but the index is the key. And then you have the value corresponding to that index. So you could think of, let's say that I'm giving you the social security number for a person, or a phone number for a person. And basically you will get, you will give me the name of that person. So basically that is what a map is. It's kind of a set of keywords, and for every keyword I have a value associated with it. There is a separate hierarchy for maps, and here it is. Basically there is the map interface, which is implemented by sorted map and navigable map extended by these two interfaces. I have the abstract class abstract map, and then I have a sorted map, a simple hash map, and a linked hash map, which are similar to the ones that we have for sets, because the keys are actually stored as a set internally in this data structure. The map interface contains methods relevant for maps. So it has contains key, which returns a Boolean, true or false, contains value, which returns a Boolean if that value is one of the values in the map, contains entry set, which returns the set of all the map entries, key value pairs. Get given a key gives me the value associated to that key. Java collections framework only has simple maps, so there is only one value associated to one key. This is the most used method, the get method. Is empty returns a Boolean if the hash map or the map is empty or not. The key set returns the set of all the keys. Put is the second used method. For a given key, it has the it puts the value at that for that key. Put all takes another map and puts all of the key value pairs into the current map. Remove, given a key, it removes the key value pair and returns the value. Size returns the number of key value pairs, and values returns a collection of the values. And the concrete classes in the map interface are hash map, linked hash map, and tree map. So most important methods. Key set returns the set of all the keys. Entry set returns a set of entries which are of this class entry, which is an inner class to map, and it has two dynamic data fields, key and value. And it has three methods, get key, get value for the current entry, and set value for the current entry to a different value. So hash map and tree map are the most used classes. Hash map is the most efficient because it doesn't have any order. It's really like a hash set. We saw it before. Linked hash set is a hash map. A linked hash map is a hash map that also supports the order in which the elements were inserted. And you can access the entries based on last and least recently accessed. Tree map is basically implements a sorted list of the keys. So when you access them, you basically can get the keys in some lexicographical order. And here is an example. I will basically store students in a map, and the key is the name of the student, and the grade is the value of the grade is the value. So the program uses a tree map also to sort the students in descending order of the keys. So descending order or ascending order of the students from, let's say, Abe to Ziosis. And finally, the program creates a hash map with access order and the same entries in that map and displays the entries. So here is an example. So basically, let's say that I have Smith got 100, Anderson 91, Lewis 99, Cook 89. I put them all in a hash map. I display that hash map. Then I create a tree map where the order is the default order, which basically it will print Anderson first, then Cook, then Lewis, then Smith. Then I create a linked hash map with capacity of 16, load factor of 75%, and basically I insert the same elements. And then if I want the grade for Lewis, I use the get method. So get Lewis returns the grade of Lewis. And if I want to iterate over all the elements, basically I can use an aggregate. Every name, grade, basically key value pair is going to execute this method for it, basically the name and the student. So the default one, the simple hash map, contains the students in any arbitrary order. Not quite arbitrary, is based on the hash code of the keys. For a tree hash map, it will store the students in order of their names. If you want the grade for Lewis, you get 99. And the linked hash map contains the students in the order that they were inserted. So Smith is first, Anderson is second, and so on. And you can basically see that was the order. Finally, another example, counting the occurrences of words in a text, like for instance, for every word, how many times occurred in a text, is implemented here. So first I create a tree map, then for every word in the text in lowercase, I check if the map already contains that word, and if it doesn't, I put that word with the with the value 1. Otherwise, I get the number, the value, the count for basically that word, and I increment it with 1, and then I put that value back in the map. So all of this could have been done into one basically instruction, put for that key, and instead of the value is map.get for that key plus 1, and that's it. Then we print the, there was A twice, class once, fun one, and so on. For the last part is really, there are a set of unmodifiable collections also in sets and maps. So these are basically constants like empty set, empty list, empty map. And we already talked about this last class. Basically, in last class, we had these array lists, which are subclasses or inner classes of arrays. And basically, these methods here, singleton for an object returns a set, returns an immutable set containing that specified object. Similar for singleton list, returns a list that contains only that object. Singleton map returns a map that contains only that key value pair. Unmodifiable collection for a collection returns a read-only view of the collection. It's kind of like a view in databases, but is read-only. And that's exactly the idea of using databases. And similarly for maps, lists, sets, sorted maps, and sorted sets. That's basically it about Java collections, framework, sets and maps. Is there also an array map? No. Up to what I know, only three maps that are there are hash map, linked hash map, and tree map. Okay. Just to check, you can actually check Java API. Array map. But I don't think that such a thing exists. And I'm wrong. I'm proven wrong. There is an array map. I didn't know that. It seems to be quite inefficient, but that's the way it is. Okay, good. So one more thing. I posted the solution for the quiz. I will not go over it. Basically, I use sets to model all the vowels in the string, consonants in the string, and then I implement it.
Professor? Yeah.
Go ahead.
At least for me, I don't know if anyone else had this problem, that the quiz didn't compile the way that like the file is being used. You have two methods in there that you're using java.util.file, which is not compiling because it was java.io.file, but java.io.file doesn't have a has next or next line. Okay.
I think I know what I'm doing. What I did, because has next is for the scanner.
I put what I think is the solution to that in chat. All right, awesome. I was toying around with it, but I wasn't sure. Thank you.
No, I you are totally right, and I'm gonna post this updated solution, which I think now it's correct. So you see what I did? I created a file, then I created a scanner, but when I iterated while I was using the file, not the scanner, I should use the scanner, and now it will work. Okay, good, excellent. Thank you very much. Good job. Okay, so then I stop the recording, upload it after the class.